Thank you. I come to you as a cousin, on this, hopefully on the same side of the river. And so my background is in Vajrayana Buddhism. And we have a saying in Vajrayana, this is a Tibetan word, emaho. And so I would like to say emaho, which usually you say at the end of practice together, but I can't wait. It means, isn't it magnificent? And usually it pertains to just the joy and vibrancy and solidarity and fellowship of practicing together, of being together, which is really one of the, probably one of the greatest reasons for joy, is coming together as Sangha, as seekers, as teachers, all together. So, emaho. And I'd like to start us off by having everyone join me in chanting the syllable ah. So in Tibetan Buddhism, ah is, among other things, it is the symbol of what we call shunyata, which is very poorly translated as emptiness. Really, it's a quality of profound openness that is empty and free of content, and it is just a fullness of what some more esteemed teachers have been already talking about. So let's take a deep inhale down into the belly, allow it to be fluid and flexible but full. This also helps us to wake up. And then we'll sound the syllable together. Ah. Let's do it again. Okay, again, and then just a little bit louder, and whatever you are holding, whatever you've brought into this retreat together, allow yourself to give it a voice, and relinquishing the energy that it may still be holding for you, bringing it this openness. Wonderful, good. And now softly. And now as quiet as a whisper. Next breath, just hearing it in your mind and just feeling the resonance, the openness of this embodied memory of this tone. Thank you. So the reason, first of all, it's always fun simply to chant together, and helps us perhaps to also feel each other's presence. And one of the things that I think that is helpful to bring into these conversations, as a good Buddhist, let's look at suffering. Dukkha. Oh, I love suffering. And many Buddhists just relish and love suffering. Why on earth would we do that? Right? Often it is seen on the path, even on the path, as an opportunity. No mud, no lotus, as the great Thich Nhat Hanh has in his book of the same title. Yeah. Clicker? Yeah. Oh, here it is. Oh, good. just in time to see the Buddha in the rain. I don't know what strikes you about this image, but how many people would feel uncomfortable practicing, meditating, and just sitting so with so much equanimity and focus and poise and softness in the midst of rain? Have you ever practiced? Anybody ever practiced in the rain? Yeah. What was that like? Did it feel good? Yeah. Part of that is perhaps if it didn't feel bad, but it you were dealing with a little discomfort, perhaps, is it's a full experience. The fullness of experiencing also comes with some discomfort. So part of what I'm going to be talking about and the practices that we'll be looking at have to do with how do we relate and how can we practice with suffering? I was here when I was 12 years old. I was here last with my father, who passed away a few years ago. And coming here was a bit of a pilgrimage. I could feel his presence. He was a very loving man. He was a theologian and a Christian preacher, very dynamic. And I've been feeling his presence here as I've been here. I wasn't expecting that. And yes, a little bit of sorrow, a little bit of grief still there for this beautiful man. But in the midst of it is this profound joy. How is that possible? How is it possible to have both at once? There's a cartoon I once saw about a seeker who spent days climbing up a mountain through brambles. Scree is a word. Anybody ever hear this word, scree? Mossy, slippery, finally makes it to the top. The guru is sitting there on the edge, and he looks at him and has all this relief, the seeker. And the guru says, I'm disillusionment. Enlightenment is over there at that mountain. Oh my gosh. And then you see there were all these mountains, all these gurus on there. Well, which one is it? And yeah, that is how it is, right? If we keep seeking a certain experience, disillusionment is part of the path, but it can also be part of the wisdom. What do you think this seeker was feeling, though? I can imagine getting there and feeling deflated, disappointed. Maybe he had even heard of this guru, but now he's saying, I am not the answer here. And so that's the point, is in Vajrayana Buddhism, in Tibetan Buddhism, we have this notion of taking difficulties onto the path. Some of you alluded to this. And Swami Sarva Priyananda, you mentioned the innermost or the secret that is part of discovery. And Buddhism has this as well. We have this notion of an outer meaning, which can also be study. We learn teachings. We maybe see the world in a certain way. Right view becomes deeper, perhaps. But then there is an inner meaning. Suffering, too. But then there is a third stage, the innermost meaning, where actually suffering isn't suffering. It is simply is another experience. But what do you do if you are in a relationship, in a marriage? I was married for 20 years to someone who was my best friend, my quote-unquote soulmate, romantic love, all of that. 20 years later, it was over. She grew up in the relationship. We were 19 when we met and wanted to leave and discover herself. Very painful for me. What was I to do with all of this grief? This loss, what she needed to do to sort of break away was to put up walls. And that was very painful. She's a lovely person and we're friends to this day. But that is where I discovered I needed a way to hold what I was feeling, my grief, my sorrow, heartbreak, all of these things. I had invested so much into romantic love. I was so devoted for so many years. Now what? Emptiness, pain, grief, what in Buddhism we call second arrow suffering. This notion that suffering is like being shot with two arrows. And the first arrow is unavoidable. It's being born in these fragile, vulnerable human bodies. We get sick, we get injured, we eventually die, we age. And so that is what the Buddha taught was, yes, this is normal. This is what we do when we're born into this precious human life. We can't solve that problem. But the second arrow is the anguish that comes with the first arrow. How we relate to that suffering. And this, he said, this is something we can work with. So you may have heard, well, there are these four noble truths. The first one is that life is suffering, yes. But how we relate to it is one of the keys to this. In Mahayana Buddhism, in Vajrayana, the key is the heart. The key is compassion. It is the recognition and the vow, the bodhisattva vow, to benefit all living beings, which is a context for why we practice. Every time I practice, I establish my motivation of something called bodhicitta, or the mind of awakening that is alive through compassion for alleviating the suffering of others. And this is what led me into doing clinical chaplaincy work, end-of-life care. But in that moment of heartbreak, when my marriage ended, I discovered a practice called tonglen. Sending and receiving. Tonglen is a Tibetan word for sending forth and receiving, taking in. And I had always shied away from that practice because many of the teachers that I had practiced it from, they began with the advanced form of it first, where you begin by just establishing a good focus on your breath and then start breathing in the sweaty, sticky, smoky, smelly suffering that's in the world, taking it into your body, breathing it in, and then transforming that into the beauty of our luminous, spacious, loving compassion, and then sending it back out. That never worked for me. I used to get nauseous practicing that. And I went to my teacher. I said, this is a hard practice for me to do. He said, it just means you're doing it right. That was it. So I didn't go back to this practice until that moment where I needed something. And I went back to the teachings. So this practice is part of a set of teachings called Lojong, or mind training. But in this context, mind is really heart. And many of these traditions, Vedanta, yoga, the Buddhist traditions, mind is not something that arises here in the brain. No one knows where consciousness comes from. Even the neuroscientists admit this. We don't know where it comes from. It's a black box. We can see what goes into it. We can see what comes out. But its source, nobody knows. In Vedanta and Advaita, which, by the way, I was very happy to be part of many years ago, like we're talking 30 years ago in Marin County, and so I kind of began my spiritual journey there and then was dazzled by all the bells and whistles of Dzogchen, and then it just kind of moved right into the Vajrayana, and I've been there ever since. But I've always deeply appreciated Advaita Vedanta as a non-dual tradition in many of the same ways that Vajrayana Buddhism or the Tantras in Buddhism. There's so much beautiful overlap there. So this is why I say I'm a cousin. So part of the Buddhist way is motivation. And in my title, I think I have the word seva, which is service, yeah? And really the heart of practice, and probably why I went into chaplaincy and devoted so much of my time to caregiving and doing end-of-life care, was really in part to put my practice to the test in probably the most critical situations that I could imagine, working with families, grief, trauma, things like that. But it was also because that commitment to ease suffering was springing out of this motivation, and motivation is a big thing in particularly Mahayana Buddhism. So motivation, being motivated to awaken not just for my own benefit. I mean, that's all well and good. If I'm sitting in retreat and I'm practicing, it is wonderful. It is blissful. It wasn't always, but now, oof. And yet I'm ensconced in this material world of teaching and running a community. I run a meditation community. We meet mostly online, but we do retreats and such. There's a lot that goes into it. So deep bow to Swamiji. A teacher once told me that discernment, there's a very simple way of seeing what part of us is motivating us, how to cultivate discernment, and dropping in and saying, am I being driven by pain or by love? It's a simple question. The ego loves indulging not just in pain, but in that which is beyond it. Yeah? It can do so much on subtle levels. So her advice to us was, am I being motivated right now out of love? And I mean big love. Not just self-love, self-cherishing, as we say in Buddhism, but truly the love that comes from recognizing interdependence, wisdom of sameness, of unity. And interdependence, a big part of that, recognizing that the presence that I'm cultivating in my meditation, great. But what about all that is presencing also around me, under me? How much am I missing here? If I'm simply focusing on my own presence, quote unquote, my own, as if there were a my own presence. And so part of that is opening widening the circle, the field, to say, ah, this tree is presencing as well. You are all presencing right now. We are presencing each other. And that realization, huh, the circle is so full. It's not just practicing for my own benefit, but that when I show up, I'm embodying an environment that others experience too. I have impact. This is a motivation too. If the ego is trying to do this and own and sort of hijack the flight, so to speak, something's going to smell funny. But if we're really doing it out of big love, then we become like the ocean, where all the waves are recognizing each other. It's a beautiful thing. And recognizing the unity within each other. So sitting here in meditation in the rain, good for you. And let's give thanks for the rain, because it is the way through. There is no going around our emotions and our feelings, but there is a way of relating to them, relating to this second arrow. So when we think about sadhana from a Buddhist view, and also what we can call heart cultivation, which is another way of saying lojong or mind training, where we are training the mind, why is sadhana important here? And the first thing is, when we begin with mindfulness, just the simplicity of sitting and experiencing your breath first. Someone asked a question earlier, how do I begin? What a beautiful answer that you gave. And part of that is also being present as fully and possibly as you can and dropping into the breath. What is the breath able to teach us about ourselves and our well-being and our capacity? So there is making the mind workable, making the mind pliable, if you will, so that we're not helpless to all of this madness that plagues us, this rumination, this constant anxiety or fear, anger, making the mind workable. And then building capacity to be more spacious, perhaps, than any one experience that is arising. And being able to see that a thought, a feeling, an experience conveys more truth about its own nature upon its dissolution than its arising. This is where it reveals its true nature as it is disappearing, not as it is arising. And so meditation or sadhana helps us to sort of see, oh, this is not me. This emotion may be really intense. I'm having a deep experience. I'm suffering. But there is more here. What we call in the clinical and psychology, decentering, or being able to hold something not by being overwhelmed by it. So that's a capacity that contemplative practice can help us with. Setting up causes and conditions for auspicious, wholesome realizations. And so sadhana, I think, is really sort of that ultimate way of curating, cultivating probably the utmost causes and conditions for a practice. And no shoulds about it. We're not shoulding on ourselves to practice. But I always think of sadhana as a constant invitation. It is just there anytime we want it. We are the ones simply who need to perhaps, well, not need to, but have the opportunity to say, I don't feel very happy today. I am having this happen and that happen. It's a good time maybe to slow down that hamster wheel, that momentum, and just take some time out and drop in, even if it's counting as I breathe, just simplicity. And in that simplicity arises what in Zen they call suchness, or this direct experience of the moment just as it is without all the filters and all the content. Just, oh, sensory, the body is listening. Somebody mentioned listening earlier. The Tibetans have a word, chos jagmo, which means deep teaching. And so sadhana, in my experience of it, whatever it may have been, yoga, Vedanta, Buddhism, that every practice can be a deep teaching. And the heart itself, the source of our consciousness, the heart, this is where the goods are. So cultivating compassion, cultivating is this sense of capacity of relating, relationality. How am I relating to my suffering? Through love. The great Atisha from the 10th century, who sort of systematized these teachings of Lojong, we're not going to go through all the bullet points. The Vajrayana view, though, is, as some of you have already mentioned, that everything is on the path. Nothing is off the path. In fact, it's not just a practice. You know, so you hear people say, oh, I have a practice. Oh, wonderful. How often do you practice? Well, I practice. I don't practice every day. But what about your path? You are on a path. If you're here, you are on a path. It's not just a practice. It's not just sadhana. So sadhana, I think, belongs to a path. There is an ecosystem to the sadhana that really matters. And everything can be food for that practice. Okay, so we did the two eras of suffering. Just briefly, three kinds of suffering that is sort of generally recognized in classical Buddhism. Dukkha, the word for suffering. There is something called dukkha-dukkha, as if one dukkha is not bad enough. We have to do it twice. The suffering of suffering. This really has a lot to do with impermanence. Yeah, the notion that impermanence is ubiquitously true for all things that exist, including us. And that naturally brings suffering. This is the second one. Viparinama dukkha, the suffering of change. So parinama, a word that sometimes means change, but it also can refer to transformation. It has many contexts and many Sanskrit words. You have to know the context before you can translate the word, right? Because it may have many meanings. And then the third, sankhara dukkha, the suffering of conditioned existence. And part of that has to do with what we call the three poisons. We are conditioned. our desires, our aversions, our ignorance is also conditioned in a way. And so here we're seeing suffering as an opportunity for transformation. I can't say that enough. Okay, so compassion in Buddhism is one side, and the other side is wisdom. And when we talk about wisdom in Buddhism, we're talking about not just intellectual knowledge, but we're talking about realization. We're talking really ultimately about an unconditioned state of awareness, this luminous mind that is brightly shining. So it's wisdom means something different in these traditions. And then the term skillful means, upaya kausalya, skillful means in Buddhism, that we can't have necessarily formulas for every encounter with suffering that we will have, but it is a spontaneity. Someone mentioned that earlier too, that these practices are there to help us become spontaneously present, spontaneously compassionate, and be able to live in such a way that the heart remains open all the time. Well, how can that be? If my heart is open all the time, I'm more vulnerable to getting hurt, to being taken advantage of, to not being self-critical enough to accomplish things. But we're already like that. In fact, with a heart that is open all the time, we relate differently to those qualities. It's not like opening the heart causes everything, causes suffering. But it's a bit of a misconception because of the need for protection. There are these four qualities, Brahma Viharas. We have them in the Yoga Sutras as well. So the Buddha did not invent these. Most Buddhists don't know that, and they're a little offended if I say, yeah, these were already, Patanjali included these. What? It's true. In the first pada, 133, loving kindness, compassion, empathetic joy, and equanimity. Four qualities that are very important to keep in balance. And so one of the first practices that I'll be leading you on tomorrow is called strong back, soft front. Basically, one that helps us in a very practical way balance within the physical body how to practice a sense of stability and equanimity, neutrality, non-judgment, with the softness of compassion in the belly. So we can start feeling softness, generosity, gentleness, gentle awareness by breathing in and out and having these two qualities simultaneously mutually supportive, equanimity and compassion. They rely on each other very, very much. So without equanimity, compassion, we can become overwhelmed with empathy, which is one part of compassion. It's not the same thing, right? The feeling level of feeling the suffering, either our own or someone else's, without compassion, equanimity devolves into indifference, apathy. So these two need to be kept in balance. And as someone who is committed to caregiving, to seva, to working with others, to really being committed to taking the difficulties onto the path and being willing to hold the difficulties of others on the path, that balance is very important. Otherwise, we'll take on their suffering. We'll get exhausted, burned out. What some people might call compassion fatigue, which in my opinion doesn't exist, because compassion is not fatiguing. It is energizing. It is freeing. But empathy, empathetic distress, is where we sometimes can take on the traumas, take on the suffering of others, and then we get tired. So whenever you hear someone say compassion fatigue, be a little suspicious of that. It might just, we're talking nomenclature here, but. So I think this, let's see. Yeah, this is pretty much the last slide. Oops. How do I go back? There we go. This notion that heart cultivation, some of the things I've talked about, is really central to, in Buddhism, what we call freedom. What you call emancipation freedom as well, moksha, yeah, it's no difference. And from the standpoint of Tibetan Buddhism, cultivating compassion, or what we can call bodhicitta, the spirit of awakening or the mind of awakening through compassionate service, has two forms. One is aspirational. It is simply that motivation that is driven by love, not by pain, but really sees the benefit of being in the water and attending to those waves that are feeling small. So aspirational, really that deep dedication and commitment. And then the second is action bodhicitta, or responsive bodhicitta, where we actually engage in doing things to alleviate the suffering. And I've been seeing so much beautiful generosity just since yesterday. Oh my gosh, I mean, so much goodness, this notion of basic goodness at the heart of our underlying nature. That is the innermost secret, I think, from the standpoint of compassion. And the other thing is, we're talking about something that is perhaps a little more active from the standpoint of compassion, that it is fundamentally relational, that how we relate to ourselves, how we relate to others and all living beings is really kind of the key. There is no difference. How I relate to myself may determine, if I can't be compassionate to myself, that's going to impact perhaps what I bring to others. It can feel easier to have compassion for others sometimes. And yet, how much more rich that becomes when we are able to hold and rest in self-compassion. And it's not narcissism, it's not self-involvement. It is truly being able to hold and embrace all of those places of pain and suffering within us. So this is why sadhana is helping us to not just make the mind pliable, but it is transforming the heart to hold all of these things. And ultimately, bringing balance, presence, and wisdom. And when I say presence, big presence, I think you have this term, sakshin, I believe, right? The witness consciousness. And it's no different in Buddhism. It is the same. In Vajrayana Buddhism, this common root of non-duality, which really is the ultimate understanding of the path, as opposed to the relative forms it takes when we practice. And that is what we call skillful means, applying the right practice for the right outcome. And then ultimately dropping outcome and practice altogether. Hopefully being imprinted by these practices so that we can show up in a way that is truly loving, selfless, and willing to be of service. So, how much time? How am I doing with time here? Okay. Well, I look forward to practicing with you. I've been so inspired by just the wisdom, the insight, and the knowledge that our other teachers have shared, and I feel humbled and grateful to be here. So, thank you all. Yeah.